Shotgun, y'all shoot shotguns a lot? Just went and shot a sporting clay match. It's a top shot deal. You know, I get invited to do these things. So I shot Tim McGraw. Luke Bryan. Yeah. Bunch of music folks, man. And they had me shoot first. Like, they, I don't know how many teams it was. They paid $2,500 a team to shoot like, celebrities. See, they put me in at a five stand, or just quick play, put a five stand, next day going around the corner, just up like 20 different spaces. And they put me in a group and they designated me like a pro shooter. I'm like, golly, does anybody else want to do it? You know, I didn't want to go first at all. The pro shooter had to shoot first at each stand, and then you had to offer instruction, anybody could give instruction. And I had never shot an official round of sports plays, ever. I mean, I've shot them a few times, but we always like, playing golf, we used to kick a wedge, and we kind of cheat and never actually kept score and stuff. This time, he had like the trapper that actually kept the scorecard. Every station you get to, you handed the scorecard. He pulled the true pairs and report pairs on every station. I busted 100 out of 100, and I was stoked. I mean, that was one other guy did Wendell Cherry. I don't know if you're familiar with him, but Wendell Cherry is like a 10-time world champion, like Olympic caliber. He made two points. So I broke 100 out of 100. There was only two people that did that, like 400 shooters. And I had taken lessons in the past and stuff. I guess what it came down to was I learned all my fundamentals early on. And the biggest thing that, like shooting shotgun or shooting sports plays, keep your head down on the gun. You know, especially I'm shooting over and under shotgun. And anytime you shoot a double, if you shoot one, a lot of people want to raise it and look at the neck. You know, keep your head down on the gun. Absolutely critical. Because a shotgun reel, I mean, you got to look at the top of the barrel, you know, you got the blade, whatever. Every time you raise your head up, even if you got the front side, the front knee, whatever, on it, you're still going to shoot high. You know? So keep your head down on it. Look for the bird early, you know, if it's coming out of the trap or whatever. Don't ever get behind the bird. So if you're looking at a trap coming out over here, and a lot of people get lined up on it, and as the bird comes out, they try to trade it. But once you get behind the bird, your gun barrel is going to be accelerated. So the bird's coming out and you're starting to go behind it. You're going to come up and try to get past it. Your gun barrel is way faster than the bird is. So the trick that you want to do is once you know where the bird's going to come out and find out where you're going to see it clearest, actually, where you can focus on it. Go ahead and get set up for that. Like, get set up to shoot it right here. If it's coming out over here, you can set up to shoot it here. Get your gun, like, in this position. And just cast your eyes and keep your gun down. As it comes up here, just before it comes into position, I just bring my gun up and match the speed and boom. So you want to match your gun barrel speed with the bird, not chase it down and, you know, go through it, pull through it. Stay ahead of the bird the whole time. It's like my trick. If you ever get behind it, you're in trouble. But don't ever let the bird beat you, so just keep your gun barrel out in front of it. And you always, I don't care how fast it is, most of the time if you're shooting at a dove or anything, 90% of people miss by shooting behind it. More people shoot because you'll see it, you put the gun on, boom. Well, you got, you know, a second or so before that shot gets there, split second, and the target's gone. So a good thing to remember is, like on a shotgun, unlike a bullet or a rifle or a pistol, the best way to think about it is take a water hose, like a little squirt nozzle, turn it on, and it just squirt it one time. And, you know, like a little stream you shoot out. That's the way a shot pattern is out of a shotgun. It's not a flat projectile going through it, so you've actually got a string or something. If you shoot out in front of your bird, let the bird run into the string. So I always think about that in the game. Don't try to shoot it with the very front of the string. Shoot out in front of it and let it run into the string. You got a lot better chance of hitting it. That makes sense. Because if you're shooting dead at it, I mean, your whole string is going to be behind you. So go ahead and try to miss. If you're going to miss, you know, intentionally, just get out in front of it, and the chances of hitting it is still pretty good because you shoot out in front of it. And always base your lead off the front of the bird. Don't just look at the bird like you play target. Try to figure your lead. Look at the very front of it and then base your lead off of that. Because once you start focusing on, like, okay, where's the front of that bird? it makes you intensify a little bit more and you focus a little bit harder. And it's just giving you that much more lead to get out in front of them and play off the front of the coach. Like turkey on the line. Just a mouth call, diagram, mouth call. Right in the slate. Yeah, the slate. Oh, 22 rifles, man. That's another thing. I love the 22 rifles. I've shot more 22 bullets. A Ruger 10-22 is probably by far the... I started out with a Marlin when I was a kid back then. And 22 rifles are... You can learn so much from them because the trajectory is... It's got a lot of trajectory. Once you get back 50 yards, you know, 75, 80 yards, so you start learning how to shoot high. If you've got any kind of wind, it's going to affect it, so you start learning how to shoot left, right, and leading targets. And shooting a 22 rifle at 100 yards is about like shooting a 50 cal at 1,000 yards. The same principle applies. You're going to have to aim high, you're going to have to play way over here, like you're going to have to play with the ball shot, kind of like that. Yeah, 22 rifles. Kids, if you ever working with kids like little kids and stuff, training them to shoot, ear protection. Most kids flinch. They develop a very bad habit of flinching and stuff by not wearing ear protection. It's not the recoil, it's the noise that causes them. The flinching and all that kind of stuff. It's like they're waiting on that pow, you know, just the noise or whatever. But if you start them out with good ear protection and stuff, it'll cut down on the flinch and stuff. And that's what the most problems I see with kids shooting, and a lot of adults are carried all the way through the adults, and they get ready. They either close their eyes or they just kind of flinch a little bit, you know, jerk the trigger because of the big bang that they're scared of. So that's starting out here in Texas. A good trick I always do with my buddy, when we're sighting in rifles like scopes and stuff like that, it's basically my little brother. I got a little brother that is the world's worst about flinching and jerking the trigger and stuff like that. So what I'll do is he'll shoot a shot and I get ready to adjust the scope. And so he shoots high or whatever, and so I can see the gun and I turn the scope. I actually pushed the shell back out of the magazine and bolted for him, handed it back to him, and he said, "We need to change it." So I let him lay there and he's aiming, and just about the time he pulled the trigger, he does that and he'll click. I'm like, dang, what happened, man? What was all that about? But that just caught him, you know. He's like, because when the recoil happened, he's like, "I didn't flinch, I had it right on it," you know. But when you see somebody do that right there, you know they're not going to be consistent. And the gun's not going to keep you that hard, just stay over there a little bit. Work on it. Dry fire, dude. I was in the Marine Corps. We used to take AR or M16s and for days on day at a time, for hours at a time, we would sit there and just cycle it and aim at a target, click, cycle it, sit there, aim, click, cycle it, sit there, and click. And whenever you put a live round in it, you got to do the same thing, aim, boom. You're not even thinking about the boom, you're just waiting for the click. You know it's not going to hurt yourself, just draining that muscle memory. Like Jersey.
Another question that nobody else has. I'm pretty sure you already know what it's about. What was your experience like in the
Alright. Going into that deal, man. I've competed ever since I was a little kid. Like I started out shooting archery competition. And then I kind of graduated up. I shot more and more competitions. I went and I shot the best in archery. And the last couple of years prior to Top Shot, I entered this competition. It was called the Field and Stream. It's called the Outdoorsman Challenge. And I'd always hunted and fished and shot. You know, I always kind of preparing these. So in the new competition, and I went out there for the first time in Missouri. I made it to the finals. Like 3,000 people there. They narrowed it down to 16. We got on TV and I made it all the way to Missouri for the finals. And during that total outdoorsman competition, you have rifle competition, shotgun, archery, bass fishing, trout fishing, ATV in the field, like seven different disciplines. But I won the shotgun event, five-stand sport play event. I've never shot one. I won a $3,000 rifle shotgun event, spent the rest of the silver event. Went to a 22 target course, had pop up 22 targets out to 125 yards, and you had like 3 seconds to shoot each target. Pop up rate was like 5 seconds. I won it. That's awesome, dude. I won a Thompson Center Venture rifle for doing that. So I went to the archery deal. I came in like second place in archery. Bass fishing, I got put smut on the heavy lot. The next year I made up with a lump mixture in the back as well. So anyway, all that being said and done, I found out, you know, archery was not the only thing I was pretty good at, from a competitive level. When I was in the Marine Corps, I did win the company high shooter award. I got a meritorious promotion. I knew I could shoot pretty well. And that show came out. Actually, I was looking for some competition to enter for money. Most of them didn't pay that money. I got one more. I saw where I had to try any weapon throughout history and possibly win $25,000. Well, I got on the website and went to it, and it was for season one, and the casting call was just in. So I had to wait like 6 months for that show to come out. And every episode, just like everybody else that watched, man, I could do that. I could beat him. Golly, they missed an easy shot. Man, I would have got that. And I went all the way through, just like everybody else. And then right at the very end of season one, they put a thing up for a casting call. If you're interested, you know, submit a resume or whatever. So I did, and they got the call over to the casting producer. Got back to the movie. Went on back and forth for a couple of weeks. I ended up having to set up some video camera in front of me. And then they would call me on the telephone, put on speakerphone. I had to videotape the conversation, me talking to them on the phone, and then mail them the tape. Crazy stuff like that. So they want to see what you look like and all that. I had to send them in a resume of all my stuff that I've done in the past, and shooting accomplishments and stuff. And ultimately, it led me all the way to, they said, okay, we're going to take 50 people, there were 7,000 people that tried out this thing. We're going to take 50 of y'all and bring you out to LA for final casting. So I went to LA, I was one of the 50. We couldn't talk to each other, and it was just like, testosterone field, room number four. We were staring each other down, and all these guys with guns tattooed on them, and, you know, all their gear. Doing it. Some of them look like football teams, you know. So we go out and we go out to the desert. And 50 of them take four different weapons. So you started out with like a bullseye target, a diminishing target. You start out with like 5 inches, 3 inches, 3 inches, 2 inches, 1 inch. You get 5 practice shots with like a 1911. 5 practice shots and then you do the diminished target. One shot at each one. Boom, 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 boom. Just to see how good you were on each target. And if you like boom, 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 boom. Then an AR-15 at like 300 yards. 5 practice shots, 5 shots from school. And they had a bolt action 30-yard system that shoot like 300 yards. Oversized. 180 grain bullets that were shooting wrong. So what they did at each station, they scored. Basically, they scored. They had aptitude tests, personality tests, and all this kind of stuff. Go back home. Wait like 2-3 weeks. Well, actually, no, while you're still there, they bring you in, they got a whole big panel of judges, you know, producers, executive producers, VPs, and Mr. Channel, you know, all this stupid film. And you're all sitting there and you get one little chair and you got in front of them in the room. It's like 20 cameras on. It's like, here's your resume. Why do you want to be top shot? What makes you think you can shoot? Why do you do that? And they just tear into it like drilling parts. Just trying to pick you apart to see what your response is going to be, your reaction on camera and how you're going to, you know, react and all that. And then you go home and they're like, all right, you suck, you know, and they tell you how bad you suck. But long story short, I shot second place out of the field that went out there. So that was pretty cool. When I actually got put back, when they called me like 2 or 3 weeks later, it was like, all right, you made the house. And I really started getting nervous then. Like, dude, I have never been on a reality show. I don't like reality shows. I mean, some bad stuff can happen. You know, I want to do a lot of stuff in life, but I don't know, you know, damage my reputation. I'm a realtor, you know, and all this kind of stuff. And anyway, ultimately, I decided I'm going to go get $100,000. I got to try it. And I did. I went out there and just tried to be myself, tried to make friends with everybody. I knew going into it that it was a team deal. I didn't want to be team captain right off the bat. My whole deal was like play under the radar, be like, you know, just do good and don't get sent up for elimination. That's like the trick to me. And so anyway, I shoot the first shot and I get picked as team captain. There goes my cover. But I knew, I had enough confidence knowing that I had outshot 99% of me. Because I'm shot in second place and then 5 minutes left. These guys would just convince you how good they were. Every day, like, dude, you know, I can hit 2,000 yards, you know, no problem. I shoot 2,000 rounds a day. And I mean, it was, so after, you know, a couple of weeks of this, you're like, is that thing that really that good? And then I go shoot against him, and he wasn't that good. You know, I beat him. Okay, maybe it's just a mind game. They're just trying to psych you out, just tell you how good they are. And so anyway, so I go through the whole deal, and ultimately win it. You know, $100,000, dude. It was probably, you know, it was a great event. try to do certain things the wrong way, but by doing that, it got me more notoriety, more attention. And it really, you know, I'm from the South, and all that, I was afraid of the negative connotation of it by being a cast member. I try to just be honest, fair, and do the best I can do, because I need my kids for me watching, my kids' teachers for me watching, my, you know, my parents, my grandparents, I mean, that's all. I mean, I just want to be respectful as I could, not trash talk to anybody else, and just whatever happened after, because I didn't know whether I was going to watch them go home or last week. I mean, I never did. I just know. I talked to quite a few of them on a daily basis, at least weekly. Had a couple of the show deals working for a couple of them. Hey, what y'all don't know, man? And I'll tell you, about 10 years ago, I got hit in the head on the hospital. I got a brain aneurysm. They actually went in and they did a craniotomy. So they cut out a piece of skull about that big in front of my head. So, lifted up my brain and I'll eat and I'll have a water with the ghost of guys and flip off the water and like deflate inside and pick up the water. So it took me 2 or 3 years to learn how to speak again and get my vision right. I had double vision and all this kind of stuff. Bad scenario, but I fought my way through it. We were gone for like 2 weeks all the time. The worst condition you could ever think of. And to me, like I got on my training regimen again and started like really trying to focus and, you know, just determination. Anyway, God truly blessed me and allowed me to come back and go to be an inspiration. You know, don't ever give up, don't quit. You know, I mean, I was on so much medicine and all that kind of stuff, and it could have been any direction but good, you know, for me for a long time. But to actually go back and to win an hospital like that, that's probably the best thing I've ever been. And you know, all my friends have actually been with me. Not just a regular dude from a stop shop, dude, this guy is undergoing some crap, and then still come out of the not sure what the point is. Sometimes your parents do good in school, bank is hard. Did y'all do my, y'all got some?
Do you want one too for you?
I got a new sporting goods store I opened in Greenwood, Mississippi called Outlaw Sporting Goods. Check it out on the internet sometime. We haven't got a website yet. We don't have everything. And then a Putnam show called Antler Insanity. A little bear deal. Ken Lancaster and Dean Davis. Got my own collector sponsor. You see me around. I've been on some more stuff.
How you doing? Good.
I'm good. She has one.
Go with it. Yeah.
Yeah. She's our shooter and
everything. Awesome. What is she? Everything?
She's a 4-H archer.
Well, the boy does 4-H archery and she really shot him.
She does, she's 42 a lot.
Hello. Just be careful. I mean, it's mainly to be safe. That's a good one. I had a 14 and then it's okay. Alright y'all, see, I suffered through my first seminar ever here. Appreciate y'all sitting down here. Pleasure. If I can ever do anything for you, just let me know.
Thanks for coming out.
Pleasure meeting y'all. Appreciate it.
Okay.
I'm an iron back.
Yeah, don't throw it out. You want to get a picture too?
Okay, make sure.